The Selfish Gene, Chapter 5 by Richard Dawkins. Aggression, Stability, and the Selfish Machine. This chapter continues the assumption that individual survival machines are selfishly programmed with behaviors for the welfare of the genes as a whole. Acknowledging that all forms of interaction involve some conflict of interest, Dawkins delves into the misunderstood topic of aggression, exploring how behavioral strategies survive and how these genes that program their behaviors become more successful in the gene pool. Survival machines treat other survival machines as part of its environment. It is an obstacle or something that can be exploited, like a rock, river, or food, except it can retaliate and hit back. This is because the other survival machine is also trying to preserve its genes for the future. Natural selection thereby favors genes that allows the survival machine to utilize the environment to its benefit. Although some survival machines may not seem to impinge on each other's lives, for example, moles and blackbirds, we must not treat them totally as insulated because they could both consume a shared resource, such as earthworms. Different species may be predators, prey, parasites, or hosts. Usually, survival machines within the same species tend to directly impinge on each other's lives as mates compete for mates, or in the example of blackbirds, compete for worms and everything else. We would assume that the logical thing for a survival machine to do is to murder its rivals and eat them. However, murder and cannibalism are not as common as we'd expect. In his book on aggression, Conrad Lorenz attributes this to the restrained and gentlemanly nature of animal fighting, a gloved fist view of animal fights, compared to the savagery of humans. Dawkins disputes this interpretation and offers an alternative explanation. He notes that there are costs and merits in taking out your rival, in addition to the investment in cost and time. If B and C are both rivals, eliminating B might be advantageous, but C may benefit from this action. Therefore, there is no obvious benefit in indiscriminately removing rivals. We can liken this to agricultural pest control that tries to exterminate one pest, only to have a worse problem from another pest who benefits from the action. Even attempting to kill a rival discriminately might be costly. For example, in attempting to eliminate a rival elephant seal who is in possession of a large harem of females, the challenger might end up dead. Although the rival holds a valuable resource, this may be an indication that he won it through combat by beating off other challengers, which means he's probably a good fighter. Even if the challenger wins the fight, he may be badly injured in his attempt. Therefore, the decision to fight or not to fight is a complex and perhaps unconscious cost-benefit calculation. Maynard Smith, together with G.R. Price and G.A. Parker, uses a branch of mathematics called game theory to analyze these decisions. He introduces the concept of evolutionary stable strategy. When we talk about a strategy, we are speaking of a pre-programmed behavioral policy because we are treating animals like survival machines with a pre-programmed computer controlling the muscles as discussed in the last chapter. For example, attack opponent. If he flees, pursue him. If he retaliates, run away. Note, we are not talking about strategy as a conscious action worked out by an individual. An evolutionary stable strategy, or ESS, is defined as a strategy which, if most members of the population adopt it, it cannot be bettered by an alternative strategy. In other words, it is the best strategy an individual should adopt depending on what the majority of the population are doing. So, if an individual in the population is trying to maximize its own success, the strategy will be the only one that persists and cannot be bettered by deviant individuals, individuals with alternative strategies. Under ESS, selection would penalize deviations. In applying this to aggression, we can think of two sorts of fighting strategies in a population of a particular species. Number one, a hawk strategy, or number two, a dove strategy. Dawkins points out that the names have no connection with conventional human usage, as doves are rather aggressive birds. For the hawks, they fight hard and unrestrained, and only retreat when seriously injured. Doves threaten, but never hurt anybody. If hawks fight a dove, the dove quickly runs away and does not get hurt. However, if a hawk fights a hawk, they fight until one of them is seriously injured or dead. If dove meets dove, nobody gets hurt and they posture at each other until one of them tires or backs down. We'll assume that individuals only find out if a rival is a hawk or a dove when they fight and cannot tell in advance and have no memory of past fights. If we award points to the contest, 50 points for winning, 0 for losing, minus 100 for serious injury, or minus 10 for wasting time over a long contest, these points can be converted to measure gene survival. An individual with a high point or higher average payoff can leave many genes behind in the gene pool. The question here is not whether doves will beat hawks. We know hawks always win. We want to know if either hawks or doves is an evolutionary stable strategy. If one of them is an ESS and the other one is not, the one that is an ESS will evolve. It is also possible that there are two ESSs, and the population would tend to stick at one of the two stable states it happened to reach first. However, neither of these strategies would be evolutionarily stable on its own. To find out why, we can suppose the population is composed of doves, then the average payoff per contest is plus 40 and minus 10, depending on who gives up. However, if a hawk arises in the population, given he is the only hawk, he will score plus 50 every fight, and the net payoff is only plus 15. As hawks spread throughout the population, hawks would encounter other hawks. Each hawk can expect to win half his fights, and the hawk that becomes seriously injured would score minus 100, while the winner continues to score plus 50 points. In comparison, doves that encounter hawks run away and are not injured, with an average payoff of 0. And in a larger population of hawks, dove genes would spread throughout the population. Over time, there is a stable ratio of hawks to doves. Under this stable ratio, the average payoff for hawks and doves are the same, which works out to 5/12 dove and 7/12 hawks, and an average payoff of 6 1/4. Of course, if everybody cooperated and agreed to be doves, every individual would benefit. For example, if there were 1/6 hawks and 5/6 doves, the average payoff would be 16 2/3. Group selection predicts that there will be a tendency towards an all-dove conspiracy. The problem is that this is open to abuse, or as Dawkins calls it, treachery from within, because hawks will do extremely well in this population of mostly doves and would evolve and populate. Under an ESS, although the average payoff is lower for individuals, it is immune to treachery from within. Humans can use conscious foresight and act in long-term interests to obey any agreement against behaving for short-term interests.
Okay.
However, there is a constant danger and temptation of individuals to exploit short-term gains by breaking the pact. We see this in price-cutting behavior of petrol stations. Therefore, it is difficult to see how wild animals dictated by the genes could evolve strategies for group benefit. In a stable ratio of hawk genes to dove genes in a gene pool, the technical term in genetics for this state is called stable polymorphism. If every individual is capable of behaving like hawk or dove, ESS can still be achieved without polymorphism with the same probabilities, namely 7/12 as hawk and 5/12 as dove. Hawk and dove is a very simple model, but it is useful for understanding a point. We can introduce some complex strategies. Maynard Smith and Price introduced a more complex strategy known as the Retaliator. The Retaliator is a conditional strategist in that its behavior depends on the opponent. It acts like a dove in the beginning by not mounting all-out attacks like a hawk. However, if attacked, the dove will retaliate and behave like a hawk. If the retaliator meets another retaliator, it plays like a dove. We can introduce two more conditional strategists. The bully, who behaves like a hawk but runs away when attacked, and Prober-Retaliator, who continues to play like a hawk if its opponent does not fight back. If its opponent fights back, it reverts to playing dove. If the Prober-Retaliator is attacked, it retaliates like a retaliator. If all five strategies are run in a simulation, only the retaliator emerges as evolutionarily stable. A population of dove is not stable because it can be invaded by hawks and bullies. Hawk is not stable because a population of hawks will be invaded by doves and bullies. Bully is not stable because it could be invaded by hawks. With a population of retaliators, no other strategy would invade it. However, doves within a population of retaliators do equally well, its numbers could increase, but Prober-Retaliator, hawks and bullies could take advantage of the doves. Prober-Retaliator is nearly stable, but only the Retaliator does better, just slightly. Therefore, there will be a gentle oscillation between the two, with a small dove minority. This theoretical conclusion is not far from what happens in wild animals. Of course, constructing a good model depends on the points allocated for winning, being injured, expending time, etc., which requires a good understanding of the behaviors of the animals instead of just an arbitrary assignment. For example, in elephant seals, the prize of winning is near monopoly over the harem, and therefore the probability of serious injury would also be high compared to the cost of wasting time, which is small. In cold climates, for a small bird, the cost of wasting time and waiting around is more fatal. Or the great tit, a passerine bird, that must catch a prey regularly to ensure its nestling survival. The conclusion here is that ESS would tend to evolve, and ESS is not the optimum that could be achieved by group cooperation. Maynard Smith has considered another game called the War of Attrition, where contestants do not engage in dangerous combat, thereby avoiding injury, and just postures until one backs down. There's obviously a cost in time. Therefore, both contestants pay the price, but only one of them gets the reward. Contestants might decide to give up at the very beginning and not waste any time. Those that are willing to go longer would always win, especially if it was just a few seconds more than the immediate retreaters. Therefore, selection progressively favors extending more time until it approaches the maximum equal to the economic cost or worth of the resources being contested. Individuals must not know how long opponents will give up. Any physical feature or behavior that betrayed giving up would be penalized by natural selection. The poker face and sudden and unpredictable surrender would evolve. Lying would not evolve in this circumstance because individuals who call their bluff could invade this lying strategy. The previous descriptions are examples of symmetric contests. Maynard Smith considers asymmetric contests. First, these can be if individuals vary in size and fighting ability, and each individual is capable of gauging a rival's size in comparison to his own. Secondly, if the rewards gained from winning are different across individuals. For example, older males with not long to live may have less to lose than younger males. Lastly, asymmetry can arise if a contestant, we call resident, arrives earlier at the location of the contest than the other, which we call intruder. If we suppose all individuals play the rule, resident wins, intruder runs away, we should see half wins and half losses. A mutant that plays hawk and always attacks will win when his opponent is an intruder and risk grave injury if his opponent is a resident. Those that try to reverse the rule, if resident, run away, if intruder, attack, will also do worse. We're assuming here that being a resident or intruder does not designate any advantages. However, being a resident could have advantages in knowledge of the terrain, or the intruder is more likely exhausted from moving into the battle area. Therefore, resident wins, intruder runs away is more probable as a stable state in nature. The reverse strategy of intruder wins, resident retreats would tend towards destruction, a paradoxical strategy, because contestants would try to avoid being the resident and hence would ceaselessly move around, expending time and energy. Therefore, natural selection would favor individuals who strove to be residents, which we know to be the behavior of territorial defense. Dawkins points to the demonstration by the ethologist Nico Tinbergen, who had an aquarium with two male sticklebacks who built their nests on opposite ends of the tank. When the two sticklebacks in separate test tubes were placed close to each other, they tried to fight through the glass. When he moved the test tubes near male A's nest, A assumed an attacking posture and B attempted to retreat. This was reversed when the two test tubes were placed in B's territory. Both males played, if resident, attack, if intruder, retreat. Hence, territorial defense may simply be an ESS, which arose because of the asymmetry in time of arrival over a location. Memory of the outcome of past fights may also influence the chance of winning. For example, R.D. Alexander found crickets that were beaten up by a model cricket lost in fights against other real crickets. If crickets fought in closed groups, a kind of dominant hierarchy develops and they would sort themselves out in a rank order. But the number of serious fights decreases. Monkeys that are beaten up by other monkeys display a dovish behavior towards the monkey that beat them. Similarly, hens that have never met each other fight when introduced to each other. But the fighting dies down after each individual learns her place relative to each other. Incidentally, egg production is higher in groups of hens where there is less fighting. So this helps us explain why we don't see lions hunting other lions. A cannibal strategy is unstable because there is too much danger of retaliation, as seen in the hawk strategy. So why don't antelopes fight back at lions instead of running? Prey animals usually run away instead of retaliating, probably because there is a strong asymmetry in the contest. They have become proficient at running and chasing, that a mutant antelope that stands and fights would not be very successful. Dawkins warns against social group thinking when analysing animal behaviour because of the hidden and flawed group selectionist assumptions. ESS can help to understand how collections of independent, selfish entities can come to resemble a single organised whole. In conclusion, Dawkins uses this to answer the question of what makes a good gene. The gene pool will become an evolutionary stable set of genes if it cannot be invaded by any new gene. So genes that arise either by mutation, reassortment, immigration, are quickly penalized by natural selection. If a new gene succeeds in invading the gene pool, an evolutionary stable set is established. Hence, progressive evolution is like a series of discrete steps.